Hello, hello. Please take your seats. Try to pause the discussions that you're in. And let's get started with our next working area, the user interface presentation. We already have.
Oh, then they're already set up. Okay,
yeah.
So who are the people we should announce?
Yes,
I'm
Scribe.
Yes. Yeah. So, give me the.
Yeah.
So our meeting style is the field narrowing one. We will give a short introduction to tasks and sessions that we will carry on in this discussion, and we have chosen the Rowan as our scribe person, Pratik as our timekeeper, facilitating is Tim and myself, and gatekeeper is John Katz over there. So let's get this started. Timo?
Yeah. Okay, so welcome everyone. We'll be continuing off mostly from the previous session, talking about the future of our content presentation. I'll briefly present the agenda for this session. So first off, I'd like to summarize a little bit of the previous session. Then I'll mention some of the previous sessions that are very much related to this, which we won't be discussing in this session. And then the actual main topic that I'd like to discuss here, which is the skin system and how this will fit in with the new generation of content loading. So the related sessions, so the previous one very much, I'm missing my notes here, I see. I'll just summarize it. So we've previously discussed in the previous session, in case you missed it, the future of the next generation of content loading, which might involve something like Service Worker, an API-driven front-end. The slides are not yet online. I'll publish them after. It's only a few slides to assist the introduction. This will mostly be a discussion. So the previous session, in summary, basically what it proposes is that we will be having a Node.js service on the back end that will compose the skin, the page content from REST-based, for example, and compose them into one page content for the user. And what we'll be focusing on here is how that fits in with the skin creation process. The skin creation process itself has another session tomorrow at 10 a.m. in Robertson 2, which is right behind that wall. And after and later in that day, there's also another session about the image styles. So without further ado, let's get into the skin system. As Volker mentioned, this is a field narrowing discussion, so we're mostly wanting to get feedback of what people have as different ideas and to try and see what the best ones are and how we can potentially move forward with that. To get it started, I'd like to mention a few use cases and a few restrictions that we might want to put on this to help us sort of narrow down where we want to focus on. So first of all, I would like us to think about treating various use cases as first-class citizens in this new system. So we have a few different use cases. We have mobile apps, we have mobile front end, and we have logged out users. Sorry, that should be logged in users. My apologies. Right now, they go through very different processes to get their content delivered. And ideally, in this new system, they would be able to go through the same stack, where as a logged in user or a logged out user, whether on mobile or not, you're going through the same system and you get the same benefits of composition and performance, most importantly. Which is also affected by things like latency, being able to run in the edge data centers rather than only in the main data center, and the various aspects of that. Now, in order to be able to separate these things, there are various restrictions that we have to put in place. None of these are definite. They're just proposed restrictions to keep us thinking in the right direction. One is we will probably not be able to support global PHP hooks. The idea of having an extension hook into somewhere and be able to modify anything on the page, skin, user, page, whatever it might be, that would have to be probably more declarative in a way that you can interpret in a separate process, not necessarily in a separate process, but with the ability to do it in a separate process. We might want to consider something like a lightweight template syntax for skins. Consider the possibility of using Mustache and think about, you know, can we actually reproduce vector with Mustache? Is it advanced enough? Can we support everything? It would probably have to be very low complexity, declarative. And Mustache does have some if conditions and repeats. There's a lot of features that we can leverage there, but we have to really rethink this and how we can compose these kind of things. And again, as previously discussed, API-driven development. So you would have, the skin would have access to the APIs, but only the APIs, right? So there's no special querying to get this extra bit of information. It would need to be in the main page load, and then the skin can use it. And this again goes back to treating apps as first-class citizens. For example, right now, the mobile apps have their own API to get all the bits they need because the main API doesn't give them what they want. And again, for further parties. So if we adhere to all these restrictions, I think we won't have much concern with third parties because it will be able to be very low complexity. We can sturdily reproduce that same layer as a separate PHP class that would do the same thing. So those are my notes to get us in the right direction. And
Sounds good. So can we share the Etherpad just on the screen? So we are mirroring the screens of the Etherpad as well to give you guys the notes. And we would like to get from you, audience, some inputs on what is your state of current problems you're facing. Current issues you're running into, to see where we're at and where our focus should go. So please share your inputs on the ideas that we gathered here.
All right, I'll talk if nobody else will. So some of the things that I just put that were part of this time here that I wanted to see if, just ask the question, and maybe I'm just not up to date. Future of mobile frontend is a presentation that we did not explicitly schedule, but it's one that like could very easily be an unconference one. Does that one deserve unconference time?
From our perspective, that is very highly requested issue, and we should definitely think about an unconference meeting point.
Yeah, and the same holds true for the others as well. Like, you know, the vision for templates, Wiki 2x2.0.
Yeah, so the future of mobile frontend, for the aspect of it regarding how it can fit in as a skin in a scalable and maintainable manner in this new system, I would like it to include in this session. Mm-hmm. This is very much what we're talking about today. It is one of the three use cases I mentioned. The other topics that were listed, we weren't able to fit in the schedule as their own main track schedule, as their own main track session. If people are interested in them, we should definitely schedule an unconference. So I'll just list them briefly.
I can cut and paste them in the notes as well, by the way. I've got it right in front of me. So it's future of mobile frontend. So the vision for templates, Wiki 2x2.0, real-time collaborative editing, and then making it easy to fork, branch, and merge pages. I think those are all Scott's, but I'm not positive about that. Is Scott here? Yeah. Yes, he is.
Yeah.
there we go. Yes. Oh,
can you step out to the microphone?
The middle two are mine. The last one was merged from, I forget who originally proposed that, but I certainly have ideas.
Okay.
Sorry, what do you want me to promo them briefly or what?
Well, so given that we won't be able to spend much time in this session, I'd say, you know, take a take a minute or two to maybe pitch them and encourage people to chat in non-conference.
Okay, so I'm going to skip the skin. Okay, well, I think the skin creation process has sort of been promoted in the last session in terms of like refactoring it to a point where we can more clearly separate the skin creation from MediaWiki core. And that will allow a lot more user interface experiments, I think, which would be a good thing and sort of relevant for this topic. So when people say it would be great if our user interface looked like X, we should think about the ways in which why we can't just make that so and then figure out if there's a refactoring we can do. Vision for templates, fundamentally a lot of our core, even our core appearance, what an info box looks like, what a nav box looks like, comes down to sort of extensive use of templates. And with projects like Visual Editor, we're kind of getting to a two-track user system where power users can really influence anything by editing the wiki text, but we're allowing most users to edit only a small subset of our site. The sort of new ideas for templates sort of figures out if there's a way we can push forward what the user experience for editing templates is like. Can we give people a graphic editor? Can we do other things? Some of the metadata markup for templates, which lets you edit slots in templates and visual editors, kind of related to that. Can we push forward the user interface or the user experience for editing a page which contains lots of templates? And real-time collaborative editing. I would really love to hear from lots of people about that, because it seems to me that if we actually wanted to do real-time editing, like Google Docs style editing of an article, like just the technical implementation is kind of the least part of that. All the user experience on the site changes, and there's a lot of really important social issues that change. Like, how do we prevent people from stalking? Like, if you can find and ask somebody to collaborate with you on a page, then we suddenly have to worry about like people being harassed by requests to edit pages, like, yes, but you know, requests to edit pornographic pages or something, right? Like there's all sorts of new problems that can occur. So I think that really requires a more holistic discussion, and I don't have the answers to, which is why I'd love to talk to people who have some of the answers I don't, of like, what chat would look like, what collaborative groups would look like. We sort of have the foundations with wiki projects, but I haven't personally done a lot of editing with wiki projects before, so I'd love to hear people who are involved in a wiki project. Does that help you find people who are also interested in editing the same articles? How would you arrange a group editing session with your project, that sort of thing? Then I was halfway through a talk on the Etherpad, so there's this other separate question about like what revisions actually look like in the backend database. And I think that's not in scope for this session. What's in scope for this session is the user experience part of that. Like, if there's an edit conflict, how would we like it to look? If there's a complicated, lots of people, five people edited this page in a group session, they all committed a version, like, how do we present that in the history? Like, so from the user perspective, what are the sort of new interface ideas that we need to sort of start thinking about to allow better collaboration models, or not better, different collaboration models. That was kind of the 113 is that last part of it. The sort of like ignore. So we'll punt the back end part of that in terms of what page revisions look like to a different session. But for the purposes of this session, we'd be talking about like what these forks would look like to a user.
Yeah, so I see if several people are interested in this, but so please go to Scott and schedule an on-conference session.
Yeah, I guess maybe the Etherpad is actually a good place. If you jot your names down there, at least when I get to like a sort of minimum quota, I'll be more inclined to figure out how to schedule a session for it.
Yeah, that sounds like a good idea. So let's put our names in the sessions behind that to see how much interest we have here because of the diverse group of people and also lots of different sessions possible.
So I'd like to maybe provoke some people in the audience to better respond to proposing some ideas. So let's propose something completely radical and random. Let's say we were to rewrite the skin system as a declarative syntax in JSON with some mustache files, and then that would be the new vector skin. What would your thoughts be if we were to do that? This is just one random idea. So get started.
That sounds interesting. Actually, yeah, my name's Trevor Pascal. I think the main thing I wanted to kind of say was that there's a fundamental problem that needs to be solved sort of before we can fix the skin system. I was going to rewrite the skin system a couple years ago or a year ago or so now. I got like really distracted with the visual editor. And the thing that was keeping me back was actually that we need to have a separate, like a separation of all of the things that make the skin contain what it contains. Because right now there's just a lot of really nasty hooks that sort of inject HTML and that type of thing that determine what links are available to what user in which situation, things like that. And when you really get down to it, Vector and Monobook are pretty much the same technically. But they both depend on this sort of these blobs of HTML to determine what links are available to people at what times and what permissions they have. And so there's a fundamental thing. I know you kind of called it out as like, oh, it'll be API driven, but like that API can be done, and Monobook and Vector could use that API internally using FOA requests or whatever routing you want to do without making any changes at all to the skin. And that is that's a blocker for moving in this direction at all. Because as long as we're still dependent on those HTML blobs being generated by this like crazy system that we have right now, we can't really move far away. I mean, that's one of the reasons why Vector is so much like Monobook, is it was as far as we could take it, and it hasn't really changed since. And that, I mean, I wrote Vector in 2009, so it's pretty much stagnant.
May I ask for a moment, how many of you folks have ever tried to write a skin or to develop a skin within Foundation? And so all of you people, and then like, okay, that's a few. And so non-Foundation members? All right. Wow. Okay.
It's super popular.
The problem is, no matter what we do, we need to fix the back end first. It's too high.
Then back end. Sorry, you have to kind of go teeter turn around the microphone. It doesn't pick up otherwise.
It's a bit wiggly.
Okay.
You can also pick it out if you want.
Right, but yes. That's better. So just following up on what Trevor said, which is just recording. What?
For the recording, it's great if they have you on the recording.
Okay. So, I don't know. Say
your name.
Oh, right, my name. Oh.
State your name and rank, please.
I'm Asara, yes. And, yeah, so basically it's just what Trevor said. We need to fix the back end before we do anything. And once we have that done, something like this could work well or something else. It doesn't really matter. The back end is a huge mess, and it's blocking everything. So he was saying that Vector and Bonamok, as far as we can go, we can go further, but it gets exponentially more messy at that point. So,
well, I think we're in a bit of a paradox between the back end and front end. So, on the one hand, we want to change. I would like a little bit more specific input if you like. So, what specifically about the back end? I mean, I know what's broken, but I'd like to discuss it more verbosely. Well, so, actually, what specifically about the back end is
that
broken
is
that makes
a
it difficult?
Problem too. We don't really know where the difference between back end and front end is, which has probably come up a lot already, but there's things where you have to deal with multiple different classes in order to make a skin, and there's a skin class that's a skin template class, there's a base template class. I don't even know how they all interact, and I was using all of them. And then there's a lot of things that are just plain not supported, so you want to get categories, but you have to query the database if you want to format them, which you'd think categories would be something you just have. And we don't even know what all we want in a skin, even though they should usually be pretty similar.
Yeah, so a good first step would be to generalize some of the abstract methods we have in skins that return HTML to also return the data, and then have an abstraction method
that
formats it.
Well, first we should write the methods. They don't exist for a lot of things.
Right, they get passed as template variables.
Right, but there's going to be a whole session on this later, so I shouldn't go too much into it. Sorry.
Hey, I'm Brian. I'm sorry, you were finished? Okay. Yeah, I'm Brian, iOS developer. First, I want to say that it's very encouraging to see this effort start to take shape. I'm, in general, very much in favor of consolidating architectures and refactoring, removing technical debt. But that said, I was hoping you guys could maybe elaborate a little bit more, perhaps for other people in the room besides me that are not as familiar with the actual use cases for skins, and just from a user or like product domain perspective, what is the separation of concerns between the visual aspects of an article from a skins perspective versus the editor? For example, some of the things that the iOS app does as a quote skin end quote is try to make images take up the entire width of the page, collapse certain sections of the article, move different parts of the page around. As an organization, as a platform, as a content site, what is the actual, I don't want to say a line, but what is the relationship between how we render and present content on the site versus how editors author that content, including like, oh, I want this image to float to the left, or I want this to be a gallery of images, or, you know, et cetera, et cetera. And how do we as providers of that platform impose constraints so that we can enforce things like images rendering performantly on various network connections or RTL support and things of that nature?
So one of the strengths and at the same time weaknesses of MediaWiki is the possibility for editors to imply to add a lot of markup. And that is an issue that as a skin creator, you have to always be aware of. And it's not like there's not like a easy separation of content and skin, so to say, skin as in the sense of markup, of DOM markup. And what we definitely have to figure out is where to put the boundaries and how to, and therefore your question is exactly pointing at this area, where to put the boundaries and how to best give editors all the freedom and still have all the possibilities that we as experts in styling and markup can come up with.
Right. So I guess just to follow up on that briefly, how much does this then, people have mentioned technical blockers for this initiative. It seems to me you need to define the inputs to the skin system by drawing that boundary before you can kind of define what a skin is, since you don't even really know what all a skin should or should not do. By the same token, is this at all related to, or should it be related to, or like merged with the UI standardization effort so that we can say this is how, like, this is the baseline for how Wikipedia articles are presented? And this is all also specific to Wikipedia, I'm assuming.
Mm-hmm. So I want to tie a few connections to related subjects. So one is there's a separate talk, a separate session tomorrow about semantic image style and beautiful layout. And a lot of what that touch, but that's going to touch on.
Separate session for?
Semantic image styles and beautiful layout. I added it to the top of the EDF pad just now. And a lot of what that will touch on is what you're saying. Like authors right now have a lot of control over the layout and styles of individual page components. And they're not really recognized as page component by the MediaWiki system. They're just part of the page. Even sections aren't really very strictly recognized. It's quite difficult to separate these pieces of content for an API consumer, such as the mobile app, to then inject things in the middle, or if you want to insert a different kind of table of contents, you have to hijack the other one out and insert your own and things like that.
Or just be able to compose the page in general.
Right. So I think one of the things that we will probably want to have is a better separation between types of entities that are on a page without necessarily having to declare them as a template, but rather. And this is tricky. I think from a historical perspective, it's been not very attractive when you're inventing a new page component as an editor to approach the foundation to make an extension. Rather, you just create another template. But this then imposes a restriction that the output of the template is fixed, right? So there's no variation for different skins or different viewports. It's just it is what it is. whereas an extension would have more flexibility in how to declare these things. So I think we'll talk more about that in a beautiful layout session tomorrow. But yeah, it's very tricky. And on the other side, you also have a lot of markers, like how to style a button, or how to style highlighted rows in a table. And again, those are all traditionally done as inline styles. And I think we're getting a little bit better at that now in over the past few years, where we're more encouraging things like using CSS for this. But this is still very unattractive because it requires using common.css to do this, or adding a gadget by default, which is then a lot trickier from the mobile app to get those styles in, because it doesn't necessarily render it using an HTML parser, or be able to apply CSS to it very, very, very freely. So you then have also a semantic mismatch of, even if you get the styles in, you still can't vary the styles or know what they actually mean.
Right, so just to kind of wrap that all up, you're saying for figuring out the issue, or to discuss more the issue of like where that line is drawn, go to the semantic image and beautiful layout talk, is that's where you're going to talk mm-hmm. about that more.
And so there's one thing I do want to point out is the MediaWiki skin class does have some miraculous methods that do some kind of page component system. So one of them is the linker methods, which have actually been moved out recently, but they used to be in the skin class, which would allow the skin to control what a link looks like and what a thumbnail looks like. This was then decided to be a bad idea, so we moved it out because it was too variable in some cases. But so a small idea of that does exist in the current system, which we may want to extend and further build upon, this idea of a skin being able to provide hooks for, like, this is the data, and give me some HTML back to render that type of data without the page knowing about it. But that, of course, then complicates things, because as being part of the page output, you can then no longer cache it in a skin agnostic way, which is the main reason why we moved it out of the skin. Because ideally, the page content is one blob. But again, there's, it's complicated.
Yeah, it's complicated.
My name is Pratik Saxena. There's this one issue about skins that really confuses me, and I wanted to highlight it. So extensions add a lot of user interface, and some extensions use OUI or some other UI library to do that. And ideally, you would want the skin to be able to change the way the UI of the extension looks as well, because it has UI components that should look the same as the skin does. And right now, if all extensions end up using OUI, the only way to do that is first write a MediaWiki skin, and then write an OJS UI theme that matches your skin. Is that something that will continue to happen, or do we have ideas apart from that?
So I'm from the UI standardization team, and there are currently ideas around that to provide an easier way to influence that. But none of those, because it's like a very complex layered. Solution that we provide right now, none of those is in a stadium where we can say, okay, this seems promising enough. We are aware of that problem, and we try to figure out a way, but it's again, like you said, we need to find boundaries, and we need to find guidelines for extension developers, how to best interact with our components and provide a user interface that is one of a kind.
Right. It's just that, we are talking about one aspect of skins where it is right now hard to develop skins because they're not actually skins, they're extensions. And there's the other aspect that it can never be as simple as writing a WordPress theme, because you'll have so many components that you'll have to take care of. Or are we deciding that there are certain pages that the skin just never affects and only use whatever interface that they made initially, like a admin backend, so to say?
So the thing is, yes. I coming from the WordPress side, I don't think that writing skins is especially easily on WordPress. It's just different. The ways that we are... the ways of content creation that we have within MediaWiki are completely different and have a lot of boundaries already included. So from a architecture perspective, we should make those boundaries clearer and easier for extension developers and also for screen creators. but that takes some effort.
Thank you.
I would like to add a little bit to that, because I just forgot my point. I'll do it later. Okay. What is our time?
15:23. Trevor?
Yeah, sorry. Okay, so I would actually suggest that I, having done some WordPress theming myself, like they don't even have a way for WordPress plugins to automatically match a skin. I think actually it's probably a good thing for us if extensions were using some sort of standard library like OUI, because then as long as the theme provides an OUI theme, as long as our skin provides an OUI theme, then they will match even if the person who made that extension had never used that skin before. That's actually a solution to a problem that WordPress currently has. The thing I really wanted to say though is that you were sort of saying like, what if we did this crazy thing where it was like this declarative thing. And I just kind of wanted to bring to light that our skin right now is sitting on what isn't really an API, and that's a problem, right? So we were talking about that earlier, like we really need to have an API that our skin sits on, but we need to also remember that our skin itself is an API or isn't really a good one, and people end up just using the HTML markup as an API. And that's, again, one of the reasons why we can't move very quickly is because anytime you change the markup, it breaks everything. And so as long as we're still using the HTML markup as the API, which to be fair, we haven't really provided anything else, so we can't really criticize people for using it, that's gonna be another problem. So so as much as on the bottom end we need to worry about the API and separate things there, we also need to make sure that any skin system that we implement provides a top-level API for gadgets and extensions to go in and modify and augment the skin in a generic way so that the same extension and gadget can work on any skin without having to be uniquely modified. So,
yeah, so the thing that you're referring to as being breaking is gadgets. I just wanted to clarify that, yeah.
Yeah, well, extensions do it too a lot,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, so on the server side, they would add arbitrary HTML without using the correct templates, and on the client side, the same thing. So I just want to compare it a little bit more to WordPress, though. Like, in theory, we could make a theme system more like WordPress. It's not that we can't do it, it's just that we actually, if you think about it a little bit more, we don't want that. Because if you look at what WordPress does, it wraps the arbitrary content, and the content is the same for all themes. And the problem that we are addressing here is specifically that we actually want to vary the content in some way between different skins very often. At least have some hooks into how specific components are rendered. We don't necessarily want it to arbitrarily change the content, but and that is the fundamental difference where we're having lots of difficulty, and also influence from like user preferences, for example. The other thing I want to refer to is the OUI component. So a bit of a paradox that we have right now is if an extension wants to use OUI and the component that they want to use doesn't exist yet, they either add it in core and everything works fine, or they add it in the extension, in which case it might not be as generic as it should be. But I think we're getting a little bit better at that now because we need now share the less variable context, the less as in less parser context between extensions and core, which means even if they write their own components, they could in theory, if we improve for further upon this idea, they could write components that actually work very well with the other components in the same mix, and it would be shared between extensions.
Yeah, I just think like OUI could be a lot easier to theme, don't get me wrong. And I just think it'd be better for us to spend more effort trying to get OUI to be easier to theme than to try and figure out how to never theme OUI. So, yeah.
So I am James Hare, and I'm asking in the context of wiki projects, which you brought up earlier. And one of the things with wiki projects is that they have very specific user needs, like to the extent that what is currently baked into MediaWiki is not very ideal for designing wiki projects. And for us to have created an extension would have been overkill, or at least it wouldn't have worked on our product timeline. And at the same time, we can't like do site-wide CSS, and we can't do site-wide JavaScript because our specific application that only applies to a very specific subset of users would be available to every single person who visits Wikipedia, which would just be a huge waste of bandwidth and resources. And gadgets are okay, but gadgets you have to have them turned on by default in order for them to be useful, and that creates a whole political battle that most of the time isn't worth the effort. It's also not what they're designed for. And so really, I just want to be the ability to have sort of bespoke interfaces on very specific situations to address specific needs. And this is not something that MediaWiki may not always be able to address in advance. And so it's what I'm interested in is making it easier so that if I invest resources in coming up with a design for collaborative interfaces, as it were, just simply beyond what I can just do in templates, something that allows me to use CSS and JavaScript to greatly enhance the user experience. I want to be able to have like these domains that make use of this custom interface, and I want it to be easy to deploy, and I don't want it to be caught up in Garrett hell, as it were. So anything that allows us to address very specific use cases in MediaWiki and create custom user experiences around that would be most useful.
We should have a long, in-length discussion later. I would love to hear from your gadgets that you try to accomplish.
Tomorrow at 11:30.
Sorry, who said tomorrow at 11:30?
I did.
Tomorrow
at 11:30, if there is still room on the schedule, I haven't had a chance to check yet, is our session on wiki projects and coordinating with overall software development, because what we found in coming up with the new wiki project tools and interfaces is that we're kind of doing stuff that should be done in MediaWiki, but we're kind of doing it on the side, and so we are not getting the best outcome for it, because really what we should be doing is just extending MediaWiki, but instead we're relying on the existing system, which works, it just doesn't work well.
With current architecture, we see a lot of authors who are trying to implement some special ideas that they don't have fulfilled by out-of-the-box MediaWiki, and then they are working with inline styles on a very complex. It's like very complex solutions to sometimes very low-level needs.
Yes.
And this is a big issue that we try to care about much more in the upcoming weeks and months. And I would love to get into a discussion with you, with my team colleague, and see what your problems are.
Very good, thank you.
Hi, Derek Jan, or the DJ. Scott wanted to know a few specific examples for what James' problem was, so I hope that James can return with Scott here on that. A couple of things I want to say. We should, of course, not forget that it's whatever we're talking about here, we have to remember that it's a very, very, very old system. Like, it's one of the first things of MediaWiki that was written, the skin system, and everything that connects with it. And it's probably also the one that was most neglected because we got away with it for so long. So let's also be positive. I mean, we did achieve a whole lot over the past 5 years in being able to vary skins and styles and all that. It's just very, very complicated. But we've also still got a lot of ground to cover. So looking at mobile front end, for instance, there's a whole lot of styles and style directives that we could easily incorporate into different parts of existing skins. But we've not done it yet. We've not made those elements part of the core style sheets and the core style schemas that we have. And we should. There's a lot of options, but a lot of the stuff is not documented, or it's not documented well enough. And it's understandable why that is so, because, again, it's very complicated. It's very difficult to properly communicate how to make these things, how to make these extensions, and how to get them deployed on MediaWiki, or at least Wikimedia MediaWiki. But it's doable if we spend a lot more time on it. So the question is more like, do we want to solve it, I think. Because a lot of what I'm seeing is that it basically gets ditched for higher priority elements. goals that we want to reach. So I think it's more a question of, do we want to fix it? And do we want to enable the people who want to fix it? Do we want to enable them to fix it themselves? And to sort of come back, for instance, to the issue that James was running into with the wiki projects, it's something that we've seen on a lot of areas. Skins for of the content. And the content itself uses a lot of inline styling right now. And the reason it does that is because you cannot imagine, because I'm from the English Wikipedia, I know all of these areas. You cannot imagine the amount of styling that is hidden away inside content right now. And you cannot pull all of that into common.cs. It's impossible. It would totally, like, you would send 5 megabytes of style sheets towards everyone. So I think that one of the things that we keep coming back to is that we really need templated styles. There needs to be a connection between a template and a style that goes with it. Because there's no way that you are ever going to make a skin that will adapt to all situations. You might like squeeze it into something that's acceptable for your format, but you will not be able to anticipate all the ways that content creators will want to influence style and will need to have to influence style. So it's something that we have to solve. It's the only way. And the one last point that I want to address is that the thing that keeps coming up with the skins is that basically we have two skins. We have the visual skin and the layout skin right now, the HTML layout skin. That's a concept that's not very familiar in a lot of different systems. I've been wondering whether or not we should not just decouple those two so that you would have like visual styles as WordPress mostly has versus layout skins, because now we have Vector, which is basically both, and Monobuck, which is basically both, whereas Monobuck and Vector actually share a lot. But and then what you see is that a lot of people try to fix this by just fixing Vector, the HTML of Vector or whatever. They run into problems when the next version of MediaWiki is released because everything we changed was not documented. So I think we need to create better separation there and also be better in creating stable API interfaces for that and testing them, actually, because, again, this is one of the oldest parts of the system. It's not tested. It's not being tested. So every time we have a MediaWiki update, we break something. We promise backwards compatibility that we don't deliver often. And then it's logical that you'll get into a skin nightmare. And that's what I wanted to say.
Those are all very valid points. For the first one about we share styles, we have styles now in mobile skin that should go into core. I think we have to be very careful on what is in core and how it interacts with extensions, skins. So the problem that we've heard here is that, in contrast to, for example, WordPress, a MediaWiki skin has to care about back end and front end, so to say, back end and front end. It has to fulfill a lot of things out of the box already. So it's a pretty big thing. If you're a skin developer, that is one of the things. You can't break it down to a certain point. In order to make your skin somehow workable, fulfill all the needs, which is crazy. Breaking that down into more modularized way and still providing it for all extension developers would be the wished outcome.
So for your other points, as Volker said, for mobile front end, there's definitely a lot of things that we can move into core. One of the things I like about the front end of mobile front end, which itself also described that there's a problem between front-end and front-end, is that, so for example, the table of contents is a page component in mobile front-end, is a JavaScript module. That is an idea that we could use in core. Like, imagine the table of contents in core being an OUI template, or sorry, an OUI widget. It doesn't necessarily, and I also want to emphasize here that using OUI doesn't go hand-in-hand with changing how it looks, right? It's just a technique to use how to actually generate the HTML. It doesn't necessarily say that we change the looks of anything. It does open the doors to do that when we want to in a much more scalable fashion, but it's not a prerequisite. We can make OUI cells be anything they want to be. So that would be one way we could potentially improve the situation. If we, like, imagine thumbnails and the table of contents in an OUI widget, like, that could solve a lot of problems potentially. And it would allow skins to vary them by using CSS only without changing the HTML. And I think that's a direction we should try to explore in more areas of the skin, is to less encourage changing the HTML to change the styling, and rather improve our HTML to be more adaptive to those things. There is limitations there. There will be exceptions, probably. But for very core components that are part of a page, I think it might work. And that also raises the question, like, do we want on wiki templates to use OUI more? I've seen a few uses of it, mostly when it comes to, like, buttons. Wikimedia Commons has one on their main page, I believe. But, like, would we want English Wikipedia to use OUI in the infobox template? Like, what does that entail? What does that trigger? We can use Lua modules for that potentially to simplify the generation of that HTML. There have been some initiatives there that I think are really interesting to explore.
Yeah. Okay, so this wasn't actually what I came up here to talk about, but to follow up on what DJ was saying, it's not so much that there's a visual skin and an HTML layout skin. There's a page layout, and then there's components. And both of these add up into what you have that's visual, and maybe we do need to separate them out. That actually might help a lot. But, yeah. And more to the point, though, or whatever my point was, anyway, we have skin styles, we have OOJS UI styles, we have styles coming from extensions, we have styles just everywhere. Something we really need to fix is we need something to actually own all of these styles in one place, regardless of which thing it is. We need to have it as one thing that's easy to work with. This won't cover the page layout, but it will cover the components. It may be able to govern aspects of the layout, so it'll still go together. That, well, I don't know. The point is, we need it in one place, and if you're trying to make a OOUI theme and a skin theme as separate things, that's just, you can't maintain that long term. And that's not even all the different things you'd need to work with in order to make it work.
So, if I understand you correctly, everything besides page layout should be, every styles besides page layout should be in one single place, because you will always have, with MediaWiki software, from my perspective, if we allow it, we will always have authors, editors, introducing their styles.
We can still define generic things that can be reused,
sure,
by all these different things.
But still, you won't fulfill all needs out there.
Not all of them, but if we can figure out what tends to be common, if we can distill down what the different OUI themes are into, like, what they're actually defining, that would simplify them a lot too, and that might be a good place to start. Because then the templates could reuse the same values, the skin could reuse those values within its layout stuff.
Well, and even if we can't centralize the CSS itself, we can at least centralize the input variables for,
right,
the CSS.
We can set the values. And
right. Yeah, so I think it's not scalable to have all page components be in one place, because some of them come from extensions. But at least those extensions should be reusing individual aspects of the page components,
right,
that we have in core.
But we do need proper APIs to define that this,
yeah,
is a blah object, this is a whatever, and
yeah,
stuff like that. And I have another point, if that's all right. C. Scott was asking about specific examples for Wiki Project X. It was up there more, but I guess one of the main things we ran into was that there was no way to make it support mobile. You need to have actual style sheets for the different resolutions for that, and the only way to do that is to add it with JavaScript. And that requires a gadget. That's not really what gadgets are for. And we really need some way on the wiki itself to make things responsive.
Yeah, I've seen those templates, and they also result in the flash of entire content can they trigger after the two-step rocket expands, like, a minute later into the page.
Yeah. And if you want another example, there's also when you've got gadgets that you're building upon. So you've got a generic gadget, then you're building upon that gadget with a new thing, and that makes a mess of the interface, too, in a lot of cases.
So making something responsive sounds very good, and I would love to say yes, this is the way to go. The issue coming from a user experience side is that we are coming from an architecture that was desktop first, and if we are implementing, for example, tables in MediaWiki, this is even if we come up with simple styles, it's not a real responsive or even a mobile first design. It's just trying to transform something desktop-y into a mobile experience, which is horrible from a user experience.
That's not
experience.
What we were trying to do, though.
No, wait.
We had a bunch of things on the page, and we wanted them to show up in different places depending on the device.
I'm thinking about current implementations where we want to focus on how to best come up with a responsive solution. The thing is that there is not, if you don't involve design, if you don't involve design research in those things, then you will come up with a solution that doesn't really benefit your users without having a clear research outcome.
Benefit the users to actually be able to see everything on the page?
Nope, because you have then, for example, super long table outcomes or vertical.
Hey guys, I think maybe we can table this part of the conversation.
I'm not going to transcribe you guys' argument about design research.
All right.
So we have 25 more minutes. I just want to encourage anyone who hasn't had a chance to say their piece to get in line now or wait for one of the other sessions. I also see that C. Scott is making good use of Etherpad communication. So if you're not one for talking into a microphone, definitely jump in, use some bright colors so that the moderators or the folks moderating can see. Thanks.
Hi, I'm Steven. I'm an Android developer. About 10 years ago, I worked on a WordPress theme for a community blog, very small. And I don't think some of the comparisons to WordPress theming are necessarily fair. For my community blog, there was only like 1,000 posts, and so I was able to work on a skin for that with the idea that posts will look like this, and I didn't have to support a whole lot of special pages. With skinning, it feels more like it has to support all of Wikipedia. The other thing that worked really well with WordPress for me was, even at that time, there were many, many, not just like good looking, but like beautiful looking examples that you could look at the source code for and pull little bits and pieces from. And I'm not sure that that's true for MediaWiki. At a previous role, I just really wanted to have a company themed MediaWiki installation. And that proved to be pretty difficult. I didn't want a whole lot, but what I did implement from the vector theme felt more like an embarrassing hack job, and I felt that styling individual pages with wiki text was way easier. Not sure that maybe that is very valuable, but I thought the comment was worth making. Thank you.
So one question I had during this discussion so far is, do we see skins as the visual representation only, or do we see skins as a mechanism to adapt to different devices and network conditions and so on? So that basically speaks to, should we aim for one responsive skin that adapts to the user's device and network conditions, and where the skin part is basically how it looks, and where the theming, the look is very consistent between mobile and desktop, or do we mix it too? I think a lot of the discussion about the components and being able to swap out different parts, that both in this session and in the previous session, actually aim more for the responsive part, where you swap out this one component for a lighter weight version, or you omit it altogether. And you see components more as a high-level unit of composition within, and inside of these components, there might be templating or extensions or other code that runs. Another remark I wanted to make is that there's a lot of overlap between the content and the skinning, actually, in this, because we are talking about nav boxes and we're talking about info boxes. Those are all content concepts, but they are also very relevant for skins. And so maybe there's actually a shared need for these components between those two areas that could be exploited.
To your first comment, that is what I wanted to say. So just because we make something visible in mobile, it doesn't make it good usable easily. So we have to make sure if we want to make progress on that side, that we are coming from a content side, that we decide is the content necessary for a mobile user who has different needs, different wishes with interaction from the site, which plays into the same area like the section element discussion. Do we need a table of contents and introduction of the site as first view and then go for the full content later? I can't answer that question right now if we want to go there, but this is actually the crucial point for me. Do we want responsive skins or do we want like different outcomes for mobile users and desktop users, for example?
So I think that we've been talking a lot about basically different strategies to solve a problem without really talking about what the problem is. And I would suggest that the problem is that we need to be able to change things without breaking everything. And I went through changing from monobook to vector, and we broke everything, and then had to go through cleaning it all up. And it was very complicated, and it caused a lot of stress for people. And it was so stressful for me, I actually like took a break from front end and like wrote Resource Loader with Roan. Like I hated doing front end for a while. I know why people don't write skins. And so like I think there's a lot of really good strategies here for how to achieve that. But I just kind of want to at least posit that as potentially that is the strategic problem we're trying to solve, and not get too caught up in one solution or another, but just really like try and build some agreement around that. If other people feel differently or feel the same.
Thanks. I'm Scott McLeod from World University and School, which is Creative Commons licensed. I'm interested in the sort of out-of-the-box brainstorming way, 10 years ahead, roadmap kind of question, where this user interface conversation will go in terms particularly of brainwave headsets, both into virtual worlds, but perhaps even studying end-user Wikipedians, and perhaps with intermediate roadmap steps in terms of many languages, the 300 languages that Wikipedia is in, and where the Wikimedia or MediaWiki is heading in those anticipatory kind of, is there a forking moment right now where you would choose one path? So the rebuilding that the previous speaker just mentioned, might be avoided. So
I didn't get quite the beginning of that. Could you repeat that?
So where, particularly with brainwave headsets, is user interface at MediaWiki going 10 years out? Would it be a queue item in Wikidata? Would it be a specific language differential link relative to the Wikidata queue item, for example? So you have sensors on your brain. You would be going through a user interface in MediaWiki, either into a virtual world or back to into your own brain and user sort of research, brain research at MIT OpenCourseWare, for example, schools.
I'm not sure how to answer. I think if you're referring to how the navigation model would work within MediaWiki as a user, how you can find and explore different pieces of content that are related, I'm not sure exactly how that ties into the skin process. Are you saying that that's an obstacle we should try and overcome, or is that like a use case we should consider in how to compose the skin?
So in my brainstorming roadmap ahead question, I'm curious where the laying out of MediaWiki's next steps will lead in terms of subsequent perhaps skins, but perhaps more generally user interface questions that lead to other kinds of sort of interactivity that might. So I'm not sure I'm answering your question, but that is my question.
Hey, I think I can take a stab at this, which is that we are not generally pioneers in terms of new interaction paradigms. I would say that the brainwave headsets are probably further out than we're thinking. I would say that probably the next step we're thinking about is VR. And as of yet, we don't have a roadmap for how we're going to be adapting our content or navigation schema for that particular user interface or set of user interfaces. So I would say that the brainwave stuff is probably even further out, so we don't. But if you have ideas around when you think the timing is for that, we'd be all ears. Yeah.
Thanks, Gatekeeper, to chime in here.
Yeah, I think it also ties in with the Wikidata and the discovery initiatives to really encourage that kind of interaction. And I think that the improved skin system would allow for those things to be more easily developed without having to overcome the problem of how you can actually expose this to the user without having to bust through all of these different layers. So right now, even if our backend infrastructure and the Elasticsearch and the different indexes that we have would allow that, it would still be extremely difficult to actually present this to the user right now. It would probably be a separate tool on Tool Labs, simply because you want to bypass all of this because it's such a big obstacle. So in a way, this is a prerequisite to that as well, and an enabling factor to allow that in the future.
Hi, my name is Jiang. I'm also from Google. And it seems all the discussion so far are focused on changing the skin. And I'm trying to give in a use case that we actually want skin as stable as possible. To give you an example, we used to think about to use the layout to detect info box, because in different languages, info box are marked out using different text. And if we want to find out a generic way to detect info box in different languages, and we want to think about trying to identify info box by using the location in a browser. So we actually do not know if the skin layout is stable or not. If we come up some heuristic algorithm by detecting info box from the browser location, how stable our algorithm could be.
Yeah, I can very much empathize with your pain in that area. So we've seen this happen from time to time when we make external changes to the skin, either intentional or unintentional, for various reasons, and how this affects Google search results, like having edit links show up in the search excerpt or things like that that I imagine might be hard-coded as like an exception for Wikipedia. I'm not sure, but I think having a more well-defined page component system would probably be very useful for you in that case. So you wouldn't necessarily need to go through the HTML of the skin. You would be able to either fetch data points from Wikidata directly or use the abstract HTML from Parsoid, which doesn't have the skin layout around it. So it would simplify things a lot, I imagine. And also you would benefit from accessing content that is unexpanded, right? So instead of having a div in a table, you'd have NW info box or something like that.
Your issue is actually very similar to the problem that Trevor brought up about gadgets needing a stable API as well. And so we are thinking about wrapping info boxes in something like an info box component tag so that it's easy to identify. But we will need metadata for that, possibly in template data where we have a mechanism for that. Mm. But we have that need as well. So I think we should talk.
Well, and it also brings up the fact that right now, info boxes, as crazy as it might sound, are actually not an entity in MediaWiki or in an extension. There's no info box tag or an extension. It's all user-based. It just is a template that happens to look like an info box. It might as well present an image of a pony. Like, we don't actually, like, it's not recognized in any way inside the system, both from the users or from the developer's point of view. It's just a table that happens to look like what we now know as an info box. And that is, I think, an even lower layer barrier that we actually want to address, which is to implement info boxes as a more recognized entity across wikis. A lot of that has been deferred, I think, into the priority in favor of Wikidata, which bypasses some of these problems in a more machine-readable way, which is actually even better, I imagine. But even from a UI point of view, it's still very much beneficial to standardize info boxes, even if they have to look differently. I find it very difficult to believe that we need to vary the HTML on that. So I will scroll down, Scott. Sorry.
Yes, so I think Infobox is just an example that the UI layout can be, if UI layout is stable enough, we can come up with some heuristic that cross languages. Other examples are like head notes, nail box, topic, the table content. So long as there is some common structure, no matter it's in DOM tree or it's in the UI layout, we could come out some heuristic to make the machine really be intelligent.
Are there kind of like semantic annotations that would help you out in your work that kind of come to mind?
So regarding the semantic annotation, the problem we are facing is that Wikipedia is natively multilingual, and it's really hard for us to have one algorithm processing different languages.
And then you have also the fact that we actually keep changing even the English implementation as well.
That was actually my next question, and apologies if I kind of missed it, but like, how does the multilingual aspect play into this? Like, an open-ended question, like, what is like your best thinking on it?
So try to come up with some examples of what you think, what are your...
Right, so there are differences between the different wiki projects and the way that stuff is processed in a per language context does vary pretty widely. Like, does the sort of solution that you're talking about or like this general way of thinking help to address that? Like, does it help to bring uniformity to the language stuff, or is, I guess, like the language specific stuff something we can't actually solve?
So there's like a few different aspects to that. The most prolific one, the LTR versus RTL right to left languages, is solved pretty well. When it comes to user interface problems, you have like length overflowing content in gadgets and interfaces, which we take care of. When it comes to parsing issues, like said before, that is a whole. It's a big complex topic that, for example, in the work of Discovery is currently targeted how to interact with search in multilingual environments, but this is a big thing where we are partly pioneering in solutions. Okay. Is this
yeah, it makes sense. There's like kind of dealing with it from an interaction pattern standpoint, and also dealing with like the latent semantic meaning, which is probably, yeah, it's a harder problem to solve. I just wasn't sure if where we were at with that. Thanks.
I would like to add one comment. And
the Etherpad informs us we have 5 minutes before food. I'm assuming that was written at 12:40, so that makes it 3 minutes before lunch.
Okay. I'll add one comment and then wrap things up and maybe allow one last round of questions if we can. So for the multilingual stuff, I personally think we would do better to bypass the language problem and instead focus on the community problem. So because things vary across languages, and there are some things specific to particular languages, but I think that is mostly a separate problem that to some extent we're currently solving, to some extent we're not. But I think if we would solve the problem of things varying over time, even within a language, we automatically also solve the problem of being different between different projects and different languages. What's that? Why is that?
Well, if you solve the problem for 80%, that's probably like enough value
I see what you mean. Yeah, you weren't thinking of particular languages that wouldn't be covered. Okay. Yeah. I made some takeaway points, and feel free to add things here as a summary.
Let us have one more question, a very fast one.
Okay. This is just kind of trying to bring back Trevor's thing and both Scott's and just in general. I guess my question is, it seems like when mobile came along, skins were not sufficient for developing mobile. So there was these two alternate solutions created, which is the apps, which use native components or a mix of native and on-device HTML parsing stuff, and then mobile front end. And I guess my question is the goal here to fix that and to not have that happen again, or is the to the you know brainwaves and just other things, if we're gonna 5 years from now, if the new thing is something that we can't predict now, how do we keep skins from just continuing to be a solution that gets weird stuff hacked on? I don't know, that's the general. Do we want skins?
I guess for the next 3 to 5 years, we want skins. I'm feeling like we're running out of time. There's two more people. We should speed that up seriously, because people are getting hungry. We're running out of lunchtime. Okay, so please.
Okay, I'm Jack Taylor, Mr. Stradivarius. I was just going to talk about the info box thing. We're talking about separating the info boxes from the content.
Can you speak into the microphone, please?
So we're talking about separating the info boxes, but there's a lot of community issues as well, social issues that we need to think about. At the moment, we have something like 1,000 info box templates on the English Wikipedia, and they all have their own logic built into them, and often they're created by people who don't really know template programming that well, so moving them to Lua or other systems would be, you might get a lot of blowback from that. So whenever we think about, converting all these info boxes to the system, we're gonna have to be careful. That's all I wanted to say.
I just have a really quick comment. So like, whoever ends up working on this, my advice is just that you can't optimize for everything. And right now, we sort of optimized for nothing. I think it's great if we optimize for something, but we need to be really deliberate about what we optimize for. And if it's ease of use for developers, fine. Let's just like call that out and say we're going to try and make our lives really easy, and it's going to suck for everything else. Or if it's going to be maximum device compatibility or maximum amount of responsiveness or whatever it is. But I think that there needs to be like a stated problem and a stated solution, but also like what it is that we are actually trying to optimize for in the way we solve it. And I think that's really going to guide us to the right solution. There's tons of really cool ideas up here, but all of them are sort of optimizing for different things. So we just need to be deliberate about that. And I don't even know what that is yet, but that's, I think it's an important conversation to have.
I'm very happy that all of you joined for this session, and I'm looking forward to the next two. Thanks, Timo, and thanks, participants here in the room and elsewhere. We're going to have those three related sessions, follow-up sessions, and yeah, thank you very much.